morning, church. Good morning, everybody here and online and watching the replay later. You might notice that we have some cute little faces up here, not just the ones back here, but the ones to my left over here. Next week is Vacation Bible School, so they are here to help introduce Bible School, and it's going to be a stellar week. So instead of the sanctuary looking like this, next week we're going to be transforming it to look like space. So if you have not returned your paperwork for Bible School, there are more forms on the back table back there. All kids ages 3 through 6th grade are welcome to join, and they will be learning about shining Jesus' light. So today they have all of their little lanterns, and we haven't practiced this new remix of this song, but we're going to do This Little Light of Mine, and we would like all of you to join in with us. So it's very similar. I'm sure all of you know This Little Light of Mine, but this is a little bit of a remix version. So we haven't practiced yet, but join in with us. The video will be playing right now.
You guys stop your feet like that? Let's try it together. That's it. What do we have on the 4th of July?
Fireworks. fireworks do? When you look up in the sky, what do fireworks do? They explode, yes. So they explode. Now, the Bible says that we have the power of the Holy Spirit, dynamite. The Greek is dynamite. We have dynamite. So we explode with the power of God. Because you, if you have accepted Jesus as your Savior, the Holy Spirit lives in you. You have an explosion in you. You have dynamite in you. And you have the same Holy Spirit that all the adults in here have. Because there's no such thing as a junior Holy Spirit. Right? And that believes that. Okay? So, and when you explode, you also then light up the atmosphere. And so, here at the Church of Genesis, we believe in you. We believe that you're going to be a light for your families, for your school, when you go to school. And we believe that you, as the light, are going to lead America into the greatest move of God in history. How many believe that for this generation? Let's believe that for this generation. You're revivalists. You're going to explode, and you're going to light up atmospheres. And the glory of God is going to shine in Newcastle and all around America, just as our founding father said it would, that we would be the city on a hill, the shining city on a hill. So let's pray over our children today. God, we thank you for America. We thank you, God, that this generation that is here in the front row will be the greatest revivalist generation in the history of America. We thank you, God, that you're not finished with America, that we are celebrating our birthday this week. Lord, we know that your promises are true for America to be the city on a hill. So, God, we pray that this generation would explode with your power and light up the darkness in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. 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 Let's worship the Lord here this morning.
Oh, You may remain standing, you may be seated, whatever is more comfortable. As we continue worship this morning, I want to be close to your side, for heaven is real and death is alive. Sing it with us.
I'm gonna hear voices.
in doxology with us, with us.
hard to believe that we're coming up on almost 250 years of American history. Amazing, isn't it? And what we're going to celebrate today is the fact that outside of some times throughout the Bible where God's glory was being displayed powerfully through Israel, the American experiment has moved with God to see the greatest revivals in the history of the kingdom. Our nation has been the city on a hill. His kingdom has been coming in America, as it is in heaven. How many know that is the case? So it's our birthday. Interestingly enough, Melinda Matier's going to come forth, and it's her birthday today. Now, she doesn't know we're going to do this for her, but she has an announcement to make. Before we talk about America's birthday, we're going to have the birthday girl come forward. Come on, everyone, welcome Melinda Matier. Now, Melinda's birthday is today. Yes, you can have this. Oh, okay, here you go. Yes, you have it. So Melinda's birthday is today, and we also have some other birthdays coming up this week. Susie, you can't get up. Where's Susie? She's not here, but Ron's here. Everyone say hello, Ron. Your wife has a birthday. Jamie Avery, come on. Jamie back there. Jamie, everyone say happy birthday, Jamie. There in the back, okay. Yes, Elsie's birthday is this week. How cool is that? Well, so on the 11th, so that'll be next Tuesday. Next Tuesday. So, since Melinda's the one on the platform, you're the one that gets the personalized happy birthday. So y'all ready? You can sit or stand. Let's all sing happy birthday to Melinda.
Grab a hygiene kit, we're going to have those made up throw it in the box, and then you can add your wild toy and the rest of the stuff. The main thing we've got to remember with Operation Christmas Child, we're not only giving gifts to kids that maybe have never received a gift in their life, but we're also presenting the gospel of Jesus. A lot of these kids have never heard of Jesus, and they have had so many church plants simply because of a simple shoebox. So these kids learn about it, or they take the great opportunity and they have the greatest journey. And then they have that for a week and they graduate. A lot of times they give them little caps and gowns. It's really cute. But these kids also take this to their home. They share with their families. So many families have come to know God just through your shoebox. So don't think it's just, it's nothing. This is an opportunity to reach people who've never been reached. So I just want to thank everyone who's been bringing stuff in. The box is over on the side. Just if you, when you bring things in every week, just put it in there. Thank you.
Turn in your Bibles to Revelation chapter 12. Now, the book of Revelation is an interesting book because most of the time we read it as a book that's referencing future prophecy, and that is certainly the case. But also it's helpful to read the book of Revelation knowing that it's a book that is giving us the revelation of Jesus outside of time and space. And so the writer John sees from the heavenly realm perspective the true full revelation of Jesus as the Alpha and Omega. So sometimes when you're reading it, it can be a little bit confusing because if you're trying to explain the Jesus story and the kingdom story, and you're seeing it from a heavenly perspective, you might be mixing the events from Genesis to the birth of Jesus to the end, and that's what is happening in Revelation. So in chapter 12, we see a few things going on. Number one, one-third of the angels fall from heaven. So the devil, the dragon, and one-third of the angels fall from heaven. And the second thing that we see is those fallen angels wage war against the woman. Now, people will debate who the woman is in this story. Some will say that the dragon is waging war on Eve and all of Eve's offspring. Well, I would agree with that because we see in church and in kingdom history that these demons started to have relations with the daughters of Eve, and they birthed a group on the earth called the Nephilim, these sort of half-humans, half-demon creatures. And so these would be unredeemable beings because they were not pure seed from the line of Adam. And so from the very beginning, Satan has wanted to destroy the seed of Adam. What about Israel? God told Abraham, through your seed, all nations are going to be blessed. And we see the persecution. So some would say the woman in Revelation 12 would be ancient Israel, and the answer is yes. And some would say that the woman in Revelation 12 would be the Virgin Mary, who conceived the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and the earthly king wanted to do away with that seed. He wanted to kill that seed because he was deathly afraid of who was going to emerge from that birth, the God-man, Jesus in the flesh. And others would say that this woman in Revelation 12 will be future Israel, and I say yes. And so what we know is outside of time and space, one-third of the angels that fell from heaven are waging war on the people of God. How many know that to be true? We are in a war. Okay, so regardless of how you read Revelation 12, what we see is that the dragon is waging war on the seed. And then we see, starting in verse 7, and we'll read 7 through verse 11, we see how there's victory. Verse 7, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, the ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. And here's where I want us to focus our attention today. Verse 11, they overcame him. Everyone say overcame. They overcame him. The whole book of Revelation is a book about how to overcome. God uses that word over and over in the beginning of the book. He who overcomes, he who overcomes. There are rewards for those who overcome. And so they overcame him. How? By the blood of the Lamb. Everyone say blood. We're going to take communion today. We overcome him by the blood of the Lamb. And also, in verse 11, and by the word of their what? Their testimony. So we overcome him by the power of the blood and the word of our testimony. Now, the word testimony in the Bible means this. It means we decree what God did yesterday, and when that happens, it releases the same power today. In other words, the biblical word for testimony means to repeat or to do it again. How many know that God likes to repeat what he's done in history today and into tomorrow? And so if we're going to go forward as a country, we have to first of all go where? Back. Are you with me today? So how many of you liked history in school? I like history. Now, I was unsure about this talk because I'm a history nerd. Okay? I love to study history. I love to study the lessons from history. And so I'm going to, my first draft of this message today was 14 pages. And I realized it was going to be about a 5-hour day. So I worked to get it down to 6 pages. Now the good news is it's not going to be a 2-hour morning, I promise. So let me go very, very quickly. Let's focus on our testimony first, and then we'll end with the blood. The Pilgrim Puritans, back in the 1600s, they envisioned America. John Winthrop made this decree, and I made reference to this when I was speaking to the kids earlier, that we shall be as a city upon a what? That was the vision for America. The pilgrims came here and they were escaping religious persecution, and they envisioned a new land that would be a land for all the nations to see and to model for themselves what's happening in America. At Cape Henry, Reverend Robert Hunt decreed this mission for America. Here it is. If you're wondering why America exists, here it is. From these very shores, the gospel shall go forth not only to this new world, but the entire world. How many know that's our purpose? So let's remember. Okay, so this happens in the 1600s. Now let's fast forward. There's a lot of stuff that happened in between, but let's fast forward 100 years to the first Great Awakening. If the Puritans, the Pilgrims, envisioned America, the first Great Awakening birthed America. Now, what was happening in the 1700s in the colonies and in England, it was very, 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 very dark. It was so bad. This was the gin generation. This was the generation of drunkards. It was said that in England and in America, 8 out of 10 people were alcoholics. It was awful. Work ethic was low. And as work ethic went down, the entitlements went up because of the addictions, and people were not very productive. And so in a self-fulfilling prophecy sort of way, the Church of England began to separate itself from the ordinary street kinds of folks. Okay? And it was so bad that most of the Church of England, those addicts and alcoholics were not welcomed into the Church of England. So this is the time that the first great awakening happened. But amazing stuff happened. On January 1st, 1739, there was a prayer meeting. Started on New Year's Eve, so it actually started on December 31st, 1738. And in that prayer meeting were some very significant men. George Whitefield. How many have heard of George Whitefield? The great revivalist, probably known as probably the greatest revivalist in American history. He was from England. Also in that meeting, John Wesley, a guy named Charles Wesley. Any Methodist here in the house? Anyone have ancestors who are Methodists? How many know a Methodist? Raise your hand. Okay, all right. You don't know any Methodists? Raise your hand if you know a Methodist. All right, okay. Everybody's hand up. So yeah, George Whitefield, John Wesley, and Charles Wesley. And here's what happened in this meeting. Wesley wrote in his diary, about 3 a.m, we were continuing in prayer, and the power of God came mightily upon us, insomuch that many cried out for exceeding joy, and many fell to the ground. Can you imagine that? Just people falling to the ground. As soon as we were recovered a little from the awe, and amazed at the presence of His Majesty, we broke out with one voice. We praise Thee, O God. We acknowledge Thee to be the Lord. Amen? And here's what happened as a result of that experience. George Whitefield and the Wesley brothers were convinced that they had to take the church out to the people. And they introduced what was a very, very, very radical form of church at the time. They took praise and worship and sermons out to the open fields, and they preached the gospel. In fact, John Wesley, but Wesley struggled with this because he was an Anglican priest. He was a member of the Church of England, and he had some of that elitism in his blood. But Wesley, against his own desires, but under the leadership of the Holy Spirit, he preached outside for the very first time, and the Holy Spirit fell. People started to weep and fall under the power of God. There were great manifestations of the Holy Spirit, as well as demonic manifestations and delivery. And what happened over the next 40 years was stunning as Wesley traveled all around England, preaching the gospel, hundreds of thousands of, well, shall we say it, those kind of people came to know Christ. John Wesley never started a Methodist church. The critics called him Methodist because he was so methodical in how he would travel, and he was so methodical in how he would organize new groups of people. He didn't call them churches. He called them classes and societies, but they were little cell groups. They were little micro churches, and in England, there were about 10,000 of those within a decade. And then George Whitefield came to America, and other Methodists came to America. And they began to travel up and down the 13 colonies and preach the gospel of the kingdom. And you know what was amazing about their message? Their message was so different than what the message was in the Church of England. Their message was, well, you might not be from an aristocrat family. You may not be a descendant of the king or queen, but if you say yes to Jesus Christ, you can be born again, and God will immediately make you His royal son and daughter through Jesus Christ. And those roughneckers, Those ordinary folks, they believed what the Bible said about them. They believed they were kings and priests in his kingdom, and they couldn't wait to come to America. And when our founding fathers, many who were rational deists who wanted, you know, a society also free from religious persecution, when the rationalists saw the fervor of the revivalists, they said, let's partner together and let's throw off the chains of Great Britain. And guess what happened? They said, yep, let's go to war. And most of those preachers and revivalists also went to war. And it was called the American Revolution. How many are thankful for the American Revolution? Okay, these were courageous men and women who said, we're tired of control. We're tired of the globalist elite agenda. And we are no longer going to crown the throne in England. We are going to crown individuals in America. In America, we crown. In America, I vote you. Through your name, I say, I vote you. I vote you. So, we the people. We the people of the United States of America in order to form a more perfect union. Now, what's interesting is Ben Franklin, as these Methodists, and by the way, that's why when you go up and down the East Coast, you always will find an old Methodist church building because they're just monuments of what was once. Holy Spirit fire lighting up the 13 colonies. And this revival paved the way for the independence in the Constitution. And Ben Franklin said, you couldn't go anywhere in the colonies outside or in a neighborhood or in a house or in a revival meeting or even churches where this song was playing everywhere. And it was, now Charles Wesley was a hymn writer. And they were kind of stuffy hymns because he was an Anglican. How many know that the Anglicans can be a little stuffy? Music got a little bit better later on. But Charles Wesley wrote a hymn called And Can It Be? And this hymn was almost like a national anthem for America. And so imagine 1750, 1760, 1770 hearing this pop hit being sung all across America. What do you think? Should we sing it today? Alright. You can sit or you can stand and sing this great hymn written by Charles Wesley. I will call it the first American anthem. And Can It Be? Let's sing it together. Let's bring up the words. Imagine people being set free and singing this song. And can it be that I should gain, can it trust in the Savior's blood, that He for me
They believed that there was a move of God
And what's amazing is that during this time, there was a woman who wrote a song, and she was influenced heavily by the Second Great Awakened Revivalist culture. And while visiting Washington, D.C., the Holy Spirit woke her up in the middle of the night, and in 3 minutes, she penned a song. And in that song, the chorus said things like, "Glory, glory." The battle hymn of the Republic, and she saw, much like John saw, a vision in the heavenly realm of God bringing judgment on the parts of this country that stood for slavery. Thus, if you were living in the 1860s, 70s, and 80s, you might transition your top hit from "And Can It Be" to "The Battle Hymn of the Republic." Aren't you glad the music got better? So let's stand and in honor of the lives that were shed in the Civil War, in honor of the great revivalists in the Second Great Awakening, let's show our respect to this era of Christian history in America. The Battle Hymn. West Coast, because how many know all the weirdos go to the West Coast? We're here. second great awakening was weird because it was a revival. It looked like what happened in the book of Acts. Well, it went on steroids out on the West Coast. In 1906, we have the famous Azusa Street Revival, which launched most of the modern-day Pentecostal churches like the Assembly of God, Foursquare, Vineyard, and many, many others. But what was most significant about Azusa Street, the Azusa Street Revival delivered on the promise of America. What happened from 1906 on was that the gospel really became, most of the gospel in the First and Second Awakening went across America and also back to Europe. But from the West Coast, from the Azusa Street Revival, the gospel went into the global south. It went into Asia, China. It went into South Korea. It went into, India, even more so. It went into Africa. It easily was transported from California to Central and South America. And it was so significant. The Azusa Street Revival was so significant that in 1906, here's how significant it was. In 1906, which isn't that long ago, just a little over 100 years ago, right? I'm going to say 1906 is not that long ago. In 1906, the typical follower of Jesus in the world looked like me. A follower of Jesus was a 48-year-old, middle-aged, white guy. A gringo. How many know what a gringo is? You have to be Hispanic to know what a gringo is. Okay, my wife knows what a gringo is. She's online, I think. Okay. So, but because of Azusa Street, 100 years later, the church was no longer 80% white, 48 as a median age. The church today is now, you people say, what does a typical Christian around the globe look like? A 27 or 28-year-old black skin or brown skinned woman. Isn't that amazing? That the globe has been transformed as God has raised up young leaders all around the globe, oftentimes women who respond first to the gospel and start subgroups and micro churches. And so, but what's awesome about Azusa Street also too is it was started by a man by the name of William Seymour. Now I can promise you, for those of you who come from Pentecostal backgrounds, which I do not, as you know, I come from Methodist background and heritage, I can promise you that William Seymour's meetings at Azusa Street did not look like the show that we sometimes see in American Pentecostalism. William Seymour was a very humble man. He was the son of slaves. Isn't that neat? He became the revivalist who moved from Texas to Los Angeles to pastor a small Wesleyan Holiness church. And here's what they said about Seymour. Seymour was so humble that when he stood behind the pulpit like I am, he stood behind two empty shoeboxes, one on top of the altar, and he would usually keep his head inside the top during the meeting in prayer so that no one could see him. There was no pride there. The Azusa Street Revival was marked by humility, where God got all the credit and all the glory. In just 2 years, it spread to over 50 nations worldwide. Now, the Psalms do get better. And can it be glory, glory, hallelujah? It's like American. Yeah, good, good, right? You're like, no, they're not getting any better. Well, during the Second Great Awakening, and into Azusa Street, and then even in 1920s, 30s, 40s, and 50s, and even at a Billy Graham crusade, during that era of American history, the top hit. Can you guess it? The top hit. The most requested song was Blessed Assurance. Oh, what a... You know that song. So let's sing it together. All right. Blessed assurance, Jesus is the bride. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation. the hippie generation emerged, and they didn't like piano and hymn songs. They like Elvis Presley. Oh my, go back and talk to the old saints about Elvis Presley. They were not happy about that whatever he did. Oh, Teddy, Linda's like, you know those old saints. They were like, that was the blessed assurance generation. God can always speak to blessed assurance. And like, a whole generation of Americans, the boomers, the baby boomers, the kids that were conceived when the men came home from World War II, the largest generation in American history, they walked away from church. And they really led us into an era where we started to walk away from our Christian heritage into a lifestyle that glorifies the dragon. This was not a good era in American history, but God, but God. I'm going to say, but God. And in the late 60s and early 70s, the Jesus Revolution happened in America. And it saved an entire generation of lost Americans. Come on now. How many of you were saved? How many got saved with the Jesus Revolution? I know Cindy did, because we watched the Jesus, okay, yes, Carla, the Jesus Revolution. We watched the movie here a few months back. And God did an amazing move through the Jesus Revolution. Now, almost every single mega church that exists in America now can trace its roots back to the Jesus Revolution. How many know that it was those hippies that birthed contemporary Christian music? Yeah, platforms became rock concerts and light shows. And the Jesus Revolution did an amazing work throughout the 70s and the 80s. Many people came to know Christ. Question for us today: what's next? How many know God's not done with America? What's next? Well, we must overcome. And how are we going to overcome? Well, by the blood of the Lamb, amen? And the power of our what? Our testimony. We need to tell America and the world the true American story. How many enjoy the true American story today? You see, since the baby boomers and many Gen Xers also came to faith in Christ in large numbers, but we began to see that growth of the church slowly level out and decline from the 1990s through today. And so we do need a fresh move of God. And I don't think it's going to look like the Charles Wesley. God bless blessed assurance. It's probably not going to look like that. And it may not even look like the megachurch that we have in America that was birthed out of the Jesus Revolution. I don't know. But what I do know and who I know is Him. And the reason why we win by the blood is because the blood gives us access to the very throne room of heaven. Amen? How many of you know that we need answers? We need solutions from heaven. How many know we don't know which direction to go? Christians aren't sure. How do we battle? What do we do? How are churches going to grow again? How do we start new churches? Lord, what's the church supposed to look like today and into the future? Because the old wineskins aren't working anymore. we get into his presence. We get into his presence through prayer and through fasting, and we hear from heaven. And then we begin to take courageous steps, like John Wesley took. Can you imagine the first time Wesley preached all that? An Anglican priest. You see, we're going to stay the same and be bound by fear if we occupy our earthly seat. But we will go to new levels and we will lead this nation forward when we occupy our heavenly seat through the blood of Jesus. We need a generation of supernatural solutionaries. We need people like Jason, men like Albert and Tim. How many know that the greatest resistance to the new work of God in a nation is what God did yesterday? So if we can remember what he did without getting caught up on things like pews or chairs, rock music instead of hymns, preachers in jeans versus preachers in jackets, how many know churches that meet in cathedrals or churches that meet in homes or coffee houses or even marketplaces? How many know that if we don't get stuck up on style and resist change, we can actually empower a generation of young leaders to bring about the greatest revival move of God in our nation's history? So that's what we're going to do. So we don't know what it looks like, but we're going to pray, and we are praying, and we're going to seek God, and we're going to move with the younger generations, and we're going to cheer them on. Right? We're going to cheer them on. And we're going to say, this little light is not yours, let us shine. And we're going to turn them dynamite, and they have the power of the Holy Spirit. We're going to light up this nation in a very, very significant way. So I'm excited. I've never been excited. I believe, I can't wait to see what our daughter Grace does. I can't wait till I'm like a 70, 80-year-old geezer. Hopefully Grace doesn't put me in a nursing home. We're just like, oh, be praying for Grace. And, oh, Grace, you run out to the front lines. I'm out here in the back lines praying for you, believing, cheering you on. I can't wait until those days. It's going to be so exciting. You understand? It's dark right now. But the first thing I said this morning is when it's dark, that's when the light shines the brightest. And the American story teaches us how to shine, even when it's dark. How many want to enter in today? Let's enter into communion. Let's enter in by the blood of Jesus. The Lord Jesus himself instituted the holy sacrament we call the Lord's Supper, giving it to the disciples as a means of remembering him until he comes again, and as a seal of the new covenant between God and us. So therefore, I invite you to give the Holy Spirit permission to search your heart. Enter in to the very throne room of God through the broken body and through the blood of Jesus. Allow him to search your heart. The night that he was betrayed, he took the bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in memory of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, and he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink, in memory of me." So I invite you, on one half of your communion cup, I invite you to join me in taking out the host, the body of Christ. body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you. May his body preserve your soul and your body unto everlasting life. Take and eat, remembering that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and understanding. Take and eat. So now I want to invite you to just hold the precious blood of Jesus in your hand. Communion, in all traditions, Catholic, Lutheran, Anglican, Methodist, Baptist, Presbyterian, non-denominational, Pentecostal, in all traditions, there's unity around this sacrament being a time where God uniquely distributes grace. For some, he's distributing forgiveness of sins. We practice open communion in your Genesis, regardless of church background. When you say yes to Jesus, you drink the blood of Jesus and he washes your mind. Amen. The Holy Spirit, through communion, will sometimes distribute grace to set you free from an attitude or from an addiction or a sin that you've been struggling with. For others, God, through communion, will distribute grace for greater anointing and greater impact. So Holy Spirit, just distribute your gifts. Distribute your grace. Distribute your grace as we enter in. And this is just a remembrance, Lord, but there's these elements of not saving us, Lord. What's happening in the realm that we can't see is what's quickening our spirit. Our spirit is being quickened. Chains are coming off. Hearts are being set free. Thank you, God. More, God, more. More. Your fountain of blood is a fountain that always flows. It's enduring throughout all of history. Would you raise the blood of Jesus? Would you decree with me? Lord Jesus, pour out your blood all across America. We decree your blood across this land so that a whole generation of lost souls can enter into your presence. You're not done with America. We believe that your plan is for America to be saved and for America to continue to spread the gospel to the nations. Thank you, Lord. And so the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, may it preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Drink this, remembering that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Take a drink. Amen. Amen.
To remain in the spirit of worship this morning, and ask the ushers to come forward. Thank you.
why Satan wages war against us is he wanted the glory in heaven. He was in charge of the music. He led the arts in heaven. And then God created Adam. He told Adam to be fruitful, multiply, and govern the earth. And he's been attacking the seed of Adam since the very beginning. Do you know why? Because he can't stand when a nation is a city on him. He can't stand the light of God. So he wages war. But we end our service today saying, give God the glory. Leave here today knowing it's not about you. Learn from William Seymour. When I read that, I'm almost embarrassed that you had to look at me today preaching. Hiding himself behind shoeboxes because he didn't want to steal from the glory of God. So when you go out from this place, so what is all about you? So I'm just your vessel. Not just your vessel. Use me. Use me to light up rooms where I live, where I work, where I play, and where I learn. Amen? So you are sent, you are commissioned by the power of the Holy Spirit to go make disciples.